I think that the selective FDA review is actually not in line with a majority of scientific society in the field of assessment of health risks from radio frequency electromagnetic fields. And actually, I and more than 200 scientists have signed an appeal to World Health Organization and United Nations to call for to issue of health warnings about the risks of radio frequency electromagnetic fields, and to call them to adopt more stringer safety standards for this type of electromagnetic field. So actually, the majority of scientific society believes that except for thermal effects, which are in the basement of safety limits suggested by ICNIRP, except for those thermal effects, thousands of scientific studies, including studies from my laboratory, have shown that there are also non-thermal effects of radio frequency electromagnetic fields. And these multiple studies actually not referred to the in the FDA review, they show that there are actually risks, health risks from exposure, chronic exposure to non-thermal electromagnetic fields. And especially many such studies appeared since classification of radio frequency electromagnetic fields as possible carcinogen group 2B by the International Commission for Research on Cancer, what happened actually in 2011. So since that time, we have many, probably hundreds or maybe even thousands of studies which suggest that there are health risks from electromagnetic fields. Especially important is a recent NTP study, which is in combination with recent German study show cancer risk of exposure observed in experimental animals. And we also know from many studies coming these years that there is a mechanism how we can actually explain those cancer risks. And this mechanism is based on so-called reactive oxygen or nitrogen species, which according to many studies, including studies from my group, are induced by exposure to radio frequency electromagnetic fields. And a recent expert board from 18 countries, which has been assigned by International Agency of Research in Cancer, has concluded that based on this new evidence coming from animal studies, cancer biassay studies, and mechanistical studies, there is urgent need to re-evaluate carcinogenicity of exposure to radio frequency electromagnetic fields.
And the United States, by the way, is stating that they don't need to change their radio frequency radiation limits based on this report.
This particular FDA review has omitted many studies, hundreds of important studies, which show different types of effects from exposure to radio frequency electromagnetic fields, and down evaluated the importance of these studies, and down evaluated the health risk from these exposures, including, to my opinion, the most important is cancer health risk. So in my opinion, this report should be withdrawn, and independent group of scientists should be involved in this kind of review.
Tell me about the studies that you've done in your laboratory and what you found.
The most important in effects of radio frequency electromagnetic fields, when we talk about non-thermal effects without any heating of exposed tissue, is that those effects depend on many physical variables. Mm-hmm. And those variables include carrier frequency, which is completely different between different mobile telecommunication signals. Modulation, which may be quite different, phase modulation or pulse modulation with different duty times and so on. Polarization and etc. There are actually many physical variables which affect the possible health risk from exposure to radio frequency electromagnetic fields. In our research, we used different frequency channel from so-called 3G mobile communication and 2G mobile communication, and exposed human cells of different types, like human lymphocytes, human fibroblasts, skin cells, of human stem cells, those cells which are really important for cancer development, to different types of signals from mobile communications under the same exposure level, I mean under the same intensity, which was quite low and comparable with intensities which usually brain gets from exposure to cell phones. What we found that those different signals, actually under the same low intensity, they have had absolutely different efficiency affecting DNA repair system of human cells. So some of them were completely inefficient, while others really affected machinery which is created in the cells in order to repair DNA damage. So that means that this particular exposure really affected the balance between arising of DNA damage and repair of DNA damage, which could be really mechanistic link to those epidemiological studies which show carcinogenesis of exposure to cell phones. So, and as I said, actually the intensity levels, energy deposition to cells was completely the same as those different signals, but still the efficiency was also different. So some of them were effective inducing damage in cells, and some of them were not effective. So that's why it's really important to test each particular signal before it will be enrolled in mobile communications. And now, as you know, we use so many different signals, and almost none of those signals have been tested as should be done in experiments with mobile, with cells or animals and so on.
So when you tested the cells, human cells, to the same amount of power but different types of modulation, you found effects in some of the modulations which had to do with DNA repair, the ability of the cell to repair from the DNA damage.
Exactly.
Do I have that?
Yes, exactly.
So, and it was dependent on the signal. So now we have 5G and phones which have multiple signals, antennas coming out of them. I mean, one phone might have 6 or 7 antennas. Have you tested the 5G modulation?
So actually 5G 5G signals will use completely different signals as we have been using before. So that particular frequency range, which will be used by 5G in addition to previous signals, is called millimeter waves. So it's a frequency range in between 30 or 10 gigahertz and up to 300 gigahertz. So we have done many studies using these particular signals, but without that particular modulation, which now will be used for 5G. So that means we have used in our experiments those specific carrier frequencies, which will be used in 5G, but not specific modulations, which will be used in 5G. So right. In this way, I can't directly compare the results of our investigations with possible health risk of 5G mobile communication. But what we have seen in our experiments that even without modulation, which will be used in 5G, very specific frequencies from 5G mobile communication also inhibited DNA repair in cells, which was induced by, for example, ionizing radiation. So we have seen detrimental effects of 5G frequencies, but only carrier frequencies without modulation, which will be used by 5G. If you talk about modulation, which will be used by 5G, it's very complicated modulation using different phase arrays and very short pulses. And what we know also from many other studies that the short pulses really even increase the efficiency of radio frequency exposure. So we can suggest based on those data that actually combination of millimeter wave frequencies and pulses, very short pulses, which will be used in 5G, may even increase possible biological and detrimental effects of 5G as compared to continuous wave signals, which we have used previously in our experiments.
In the United States, they're using both low band frequencies, mid band frequencies, and high band frequencies for 5G. But I'd like to talk about children and stem cells. I understand that you published on that. There are more active stem cells in children. And what have you found out about stem cells in your research?
When we compare the data obtained with different types of human cells, and as I said, we use three different types. Cells from blood, lymphocytes, cells from skin, fibroblasts, and stem cells. Mm-hmm. When we compare the response of those different cell types to the same signals at very low intensity, non-thermal intensity, comparable with those intensities which we get usually in our brain by using of mobile phones. So we found that the stem cells are most sensitive as compared to other cell types like blood cells and skin cells. And that is very important because of we know that stem cells, they really represent the origin, the cell origin for creation of cancer. So mm-hmm. if cancer is created in blood, like leukemia, so that deals with hematopoietic stem cells. If cancer created in tissues, it deals with other types of stem cells, like, for example, mesenchymal stem cells.
How many studies have you published on this, and what is the next step that is happening scientifically to investigate this?
So we have published tens of studies, so I can't tell exactly how many, because I have been working in this area more than 40 years already now. So I started in I think I started in 1986 to research electromagnetic fields, and particularly radio frequency electromagnetic fields. So actually I have started with that particular frequency range, which will be used now in 5G with millimeter waves. So with millimeter waves, I have published tens of studies since 1986. So, but to my opinion, we have enough data actually for reclassification of carcinogenicity induced by non-thermal radio frequency exposure. But the future plans, I believe, should be validation of all specific radio frequency signals which are going to be used in mobile communication before this particular, any particular signal which be enrolled and in common use. And a set of studies should be performed by, with any particular signal, including studies with cells in vitro and studies with animals, so-called cancer bias cells. So, and of course, I strongly believe that there is a possibility to find out those particular signals which will be safe for human health, and which should be used based on that predominantly for mobile communication. I have started my scientific career in Moscow in 1986 after defense of my PhD. And I started with investigation of millimeter waves, this particular frequency range which will be involved in 5G mobile communication. In parallel, I did investigations with extremely low frequency magnetic fields. And I headed a laboratory in Moscow Engineering Physics Institute with focus on these particular fields, millimeter waves and extremely low frequency magnetic fields. Then I moved to Sweden, to Stockholm, where I worked in Stockholm University, doing several projects also dealing with electromagnetic fields, mostly with fields emitted by mobile phones, and also doing research with so-called hyper-electrosensitivity to electromagnetic fields. So, and in 2007, I moved to Slovakia, where I work now in Slovak Academy of Science as a head of radiobiological department at Cancer Research Institute. Mm-hmm. So the focus of our investigation is electromagnetic fields, low frequency and radio frequency electromagnetic fields, and ionizing radiation. So it's actually radiobiological department which I chair right now.
Well, thank you very much for sharing this with us. Any thoughts you have about the current limits of ICNIRP and the way that the guidelines that ICNIRP has put forward?
Yes. In line with many other experts, I'm sure that those standards do protect us from health effects dealing with thermal effects of radio frequency electromagnetic fields. So that means with health effects dealing with heating. But these particular ICNIRP guidelines do not protect public from chronic exposure to non-thermal magnetic electromagnetic fields, like, for example, from cell phones or from Wi-Fi or from any other source of electromagnetic radiation, which does not hit tissue. So all those exposures which are characterized by low intensity and chronic duration of exposure, all those exposures are not relevant to ICNIRP standards, and ICNIRP standards do not protect us from those chronic exposures at non-thermal levels.